Yeah, India is an incredibly diverse country. It's more diverse than like the United States. Even so much that so in the United States, I think race is typically the first identifier for people. Like, oh, it was a white guy, or oh, it was a black guy, or oh, it was a like a Latino guy. But in India, religion is definitely the first identifier. It was a Hindu guy. It was a Christian guy. It was a Muslim guy. I mean, and that's not and names mean something in India too. You can tell a guy's Muslim because of his name. You can tell a guy's Hindu because of his name. And Christians usually have biblical names in India. I think they're called the Dravidians. The original people of India were the Dravidians, and they're darker skinned typically. And then I think you had conquering Aryans come in from the Middle East. And they, I think, kind of geographically even pushed. I mean, I'm sure they killed people and then they lived in those places they were moving into. And so the South are typically more Dravidian type people. They're usually a little darker skinned and they typically speak. So there's a state called Andhra Pradesh. It was actually a month ago split into two states. I don't know the name of the new one. India is still getting new states in their country, so all the time. But Andhra Pradesh, everyone in that state typically speaks the language Telugu. And we have the Book of Mormon in Telugu, but the church is only in English in there, in that state still. Hyderabad, where the stake is, that's the capital of Andhra Pradesh. And Andhra Pradesh, I think, had the best food. It was awesome. Then there's a state called Tamil Nadu, and in Tamil Nadu they speak Tamil. Everyone in India speaks like five languages, pretty at least. But you always have your main language. So Tamil Nadu, they speak Tamil. And actually in Sri Lanka, they have the native people of Sri Lanka speak Konkani, but then you have the Tamil Tigers, and there's been a civil war going on in Sri Lanka for 30 years, which I think ended last year actually. And the Tamil Tigers were, I think, from Tamil Nadu, and they had come down and were trying to ultimately take over Sri Lanka. Then you had like the state of Karnataka, where Bangalore is actually. Which Bangalore, when I was there, the Indian government changed the name of Bangalore back to Bengaluru, and so, which was kind of pre-British for it. The British changed it to Bangalore, apparently. And so, I mean, you have major languages that are spoken by, I mean, I think there's 40 languages in India spoken by over 1 million people, which is a lot. And then you have another 900 languages, which are more just kind of, a lot of them are dialects, and a lot of them are just the tribal language. I had a companion who was teaching a guy in New Delhi. I was companions with Elder Rowe in Bangalore, but he was teaching this guy in New Delhi who's from some village in northeast India, which is starting to get more Nepali and starting to get a little more Asian. People are looking a little more Asian than just Indian, I guess. And this guy had killed and eaten two people because he was from a cannibal village, and his dad was the king of the village and he was the prince of the village. And it was just some guy. It's not like there wasn't any huge manhunt for him or anything. And India's, I mean, it's a wild place. It was, but they called our mission president and he was like, drop him. The church can't handle that right now here. I mean, the church in India, it's like kind of, it's still like pretty young. And one of the things that was a little bit sad, I guess, is one of the branches I served in, at least, there was tons of just backbiting, and this was not typical of India. Most people in India were really loving, but there was tons of backbiting going on, and a lot of members of that branch had been that branch president and then that branch, and that branch actually had a higher number of return missionaries than most branches. And so I think there was some pride that had seeped into the members kind of, and they kind of thought they knew everything. And there were some problems in that branch, and that was atypical for India, kind of, I feel like, but we were kind of in the middle of it. And, you know, our mission president I sat and talked to him about it for a while. He compared it a lot to just early days in the church, where there was just like kind of seeds of discontent growing, and people were really just talking about Joseph Smith, and there was a lot of backbiting going on then too. And that's where the church kind of is in India. It's just young. It's young. There's actually more members of the church in Pakistan than there are in India. There's no American elders in Pakistan, but we do have Pakistani elders. And I don't think they have quite the restrictions of just baptizing that we did in India. And Pakistan's actually in the New Delhi mission now. But, you know, that's like one of the things. It's kind of, I mean, it's wild. And we were, as missionaries, we were just out there. I mean, we could do whatever we want. There's no way the mission president would know unless someone told him, you know. But all the missionaries I served with were just obedient, hardworking, good guys. The Indians were all awesome. When elders would get arrested and things, I heard countless stories of their companions being an Indian elder, and the guys saying, "Hey, if you sign this letter that he like forced you to convert and is going around making you convert people, we'll buy you a bus ticket. You can go home." And the Indian elders would always say, "Nope, he's my companion. I'm sticking with him." And they were just loyal and good. They were good people. And I think that's just how Indians are. I think they're generally good, really good people.